the role that anti-communist ideology, anti-communist mythology plays in shaping the way the CIA does what it does. We have with us two people eminently suitable for that discussion. One who was a case officer for the CIA and one who was an agent for the CIA. On my right is Phillip Agee, who spent some 12 years in the CIA as a case officer, primarily in Latin America, in Mexico, Uruguay, Ecuador. And, well, I was going to say, but the man who started it all, the first person who ever left the CIA and talked about it. And although the mainstream media may refer to Phillip Agee as a renegade, which is their favorite word, for us, I think he was a godsend. Indeed, he began a noble tradition that people like Ralph McGehee and John Stockwell and others have joined. And we can only hope that more and more people who serve in the more brutal branches of the American government will find the moral revulsion that Phil Agee found and come out of the closet and tell us about it. Move it away from? It's too close, sorry. I thought someone told me to put it close. Okay. It was Alex spreading disinformation. On my left is another hero of this same sort. Edgar Chamorro was a well-known Nicaraguan, the descendant of four Nicaraguan presidents. One of the Chamorros, they're all related to each other, and one who, for whatever reasons of misunderstanding, fled Nicaragua at the time of the triumph of the Sandinista Revolution, went to Miami, where a short time later he was approached by the CIA and recruited to join the Contra leadership. Edgar had worked, among other jobs, in public relations in Nicaragua, and the CIA thought he would be an ideal person to become a spokesman for the Contras, to become a public relations leader for the Contras. Edgar also was a Jesuit priest who had actually spent time assigned to a church in the Bronx and had been dean of the Jesuit University in Managua and had been a professor of philosophy. These were not the occupations that impressed the CIA as much, of course, as his public relations background. But I think those were the occupations that ultimately caused him also to see the moral problems with what he was doing, to see the lies that he was doing, and to learn firsthand how he was being used. So we have a user and a usee with us today, and I think it will help give a broad perspective of the way the CIA works and the way it uses anti-communism. We're going to allow half the time this afternoon for questions, and I will begin now by turning the floor over to Phillip Agee.
I don't want to start out by insulting anyone, but I have a feeling that I started out as a young man like many of you. I was brought up and educated to respect the institutions of the United States, the political, economic, social system. I was, in fact, a privileged beneficiary of this system. My father was a successful businessman, and I grew up in a kind of a country club environment. I went to private schools, Jesuits in high school, then on to the University of Notre Dame. It was during my final year there that the CIA came and approached me, asked me to go into what they considered to be their most important training program. Well, I had the perfect profile for that during those 1950s because I had gone through the high school period and the university period in late 40s up through the mid 50s. This was the period, as everyone knows, of Joe McCarthy, the McCarthy period, and also the height of the war, the Cold War, and I was, in fact, a true believer in the crusade and holy war against communism. All of my formation had been typical anti-communist of that period. And so it was only natural that someone with this background accept the CIA's recruitment. And at age 22, I was in the CIA beginning to go about the work to preserve the United States, this best of all possible worlds, from the menace of Soviet expansionism and world communist threats. One of the reasons I was able to do this so easily was that I received my university degree, an honors degree, in fact, in philosophy, but I didn't have any education at all. No political education. And it wasn't until I went down to Latin America, which began in 1960, I was 25 then, having completed the CIA's training course and some military service, at age 25, down in South America, undercover as a US diplomat, taking over operations which my predecessor had been running, and being under pressure, as is every CIA operations officer in the field, pressure to develop new operations. To do this, you have to learn to speak the language. You have to be able to circulate in as wide a sphere as possible where the potential recruits are. This means undertaking all kinds of leisure activities. I played a lot of golf at that point. There are others who do a lot of fishing. All these activities which will bring a person into contact with the people who the CIA is interested in recruiting. In fact, my last job in the CIA was just that. I was sent down to Mexico in 1967 as the United States Olympic attaché for the 68 Games. In fact, I was still a CIA officer, but that was my cover. I went down a year and a half before the Games, and my job was to look around among all these several thousand people in the Olympic organizing milieu a year and a half before the Games, in order to spot and assess those who would be most useful to the Mexico City CIA program. Well, eventually, having seen the realities of Latin America, having seen the results of our work, that is that we were supporting the traditional power structures in Latin America. We were supporting what is known as the oligarchies. Despite all the talk of reform of that period, in the early 60s, you know, Kennedy established what was called the Alliance for Progress, and there was going to be a great infusion of capital and technology to Latin America in order to ease these prevailing social and economic injustices, which everyone agreed were atrocious. This was going to be done through economic growth, and on the Latin American side, they were going to install reforms to ease these injustices, such things as fiscal reform, land reform, and so forth. But the more I was down there, and particularly with the invasion of the Dominican Republic in 1965, I came to the conclusion, little by little, that all that talk about reform was just that, mostly talk. And in fact, no country in Latin America, save Cuba, which was the enemy still, had changed their societies in any meaningful way. So I decided I would leave the CIA, both for those political reasons and for personal reasons. It happened that my wife and I had separated. We were in process of having a divorce. I had gone down to Mexico alone, and it fell to me to work with a certain person in the organizing committee for the Olympic Games who had been assigned to work with the U.S. Embassy. And it happened that this person was very attractive and thought that Che Guevara was the most wonderful man in the world. We fell in love, and I had a double deception to handle. For the remaining months in the CIA, I couldn't tell them about her, and her politics, or especially about her politics, because they would have considered that to be a security threat. And of course, I could never tell her about the CIA or my participation in it because she'd never seen me. She would never have spoken to me again. Well, I left the agency for both those personal and political reasons, and with the idea of simply starting a new life, forgetting all about that work I'd done before in the agency. And in fact, I enrolled in the National University of Mexico in a doctoral program in Latin American history and culture with the idea of coming back to the United States, perhaps, to teach. Well, I was in this program, and it was a kind of in this study, and it was a radicalizing experience because I was learning more and more about the realities and history of Latin America and where my work had played a role, a contemporary role in these matters. And within a year after leaving the agency, I began to think the unthinkable. Those old pressures of disciplines of secrecy and security consciousness had faded away, or beginning to fade, and I began to think about the possibility of a book. Well, all this has to do with coming to grips with this anti-communism with which I had grown up, because the CIA was established back in 1947 as an action arm of the president, without a policy of its own. It does what it is told to do by the President of the United States. That is what the law says, and that is the way it has always been up to the 1980s, that is the Casey Reagan years, when they tried to establish this off-the-shelf, off-the-books capability. But anti-communism, naturally, was the justification for everything practically that the CIA does, even though in many cases the objects of our operations are far from being communists. Take Juan Bosch, for example, in the Dominican Republic. Take Salvador Allende in Chile. Take Goulart in Brazil in the early 1960s. Take Mossadegh, who was an anti-communist. He was a nationalist. Anti-communism, though, is used as the emotional rubric, or in political rubric, actually, to cover and to justify these subversive operations abroad. They are subversive in the sense that from the very beginning, the CIA has used money and control over people to seek control over the so-called free, pluralistic, democratic institutions of other countries. This is what became known as covert action. It began at the very beginning, at the first meeting of the National Security Council in 1947, following the passage of the National Security Act, which established the CIA and the National Security Council, the NSC, as the highest policy-making body in matters of foreign affairs and national security, chaired by the President of the United States, having as statutory members the Vice President, the Secretaries of State and Defense, and various other high-level officials, including the director of what today is known, had a different name then, but what today is known as the Federal Emergency Management Agency, FEMA. The CIA is simply an instrument, and has been all through these years, an instrument of this National Security Council and the President himself. It has no policy of its own. It does not make policy. At the very first meeting of the NSC, the decision was taken to set aside $10 million, a huge amount of money in those days, for secret intervention by the CIA in the Italian elections coming up in April 1948. The fear in Washington was that the coalition of socialists, communists, and others would win the elections. After all, they had been the backbone of resistance to some 20 years of fascism in Italy. And now, in the first national elections following liberation by the Allies in 1944, the Italian people might give victory to the left. And so this $10 million was passed in through front organizations in Italy, through Italian-American organizations in this country, through the Vatican, and the result was the Christian Democrats won very easily. It's hard to measure and determine in any of these types of operations what difference the money made, but there was euphoria in Washington, and the bureaucratic machinery was then set up to continue and expand these operations, this type of thing, worldwide, and not only in electoral processes, but in the institutions of power of countries all around the world. And these institutions are the political parties, of course, the governments, the military and security services, the trade unions, youth and student organizations, women's groups, religion, cultural and professional societies, and in a very big way, the public information media. It's done through infiltrating or recruiting people, indigenous people, inside these organizations, giving them money for the organization, but also paying them a salary as a control factor. Control is a word that every CIA trainee learns early on. It means long-range control of the natural resources, the labor, and the markets of other countries, but it also means control over individuals. And those personal salaries are a control factor. Every CIA agent, and I'm not talking about myself, I'm talking about agents who are the indigenous people working for the agency, as opposed to the staff officer, which I was, the agents are supposed to do exactly what they're told to do with the money they're given. And this is a factor, as I say, which every CIA trainee learns at the beginning. Well, the purpose of these covert action operations was to affect events in a given country. They were, as I demonstrated with the Italian election, they were from the very beginning going on, and they continued on until today. There has never been a pause in these kinds of operations. And under the Reagan administration, of course, they've been very strongly emphasized and given generous funding around the world. Well, it wasn't until much, much later in my life that I began to understand that anti-communism was used to cover or to justify all of these types of activities when in actual fact the objects or victims of these activities were not, in many cases, communists at all. They were nationalists, they were populists, they were perhaps socialists. But I began to ask myself at one point, why is it that social or popular revolution in an impoverished country is such a threat to the United States? Because almost by definition of the anti-communist political culture in which we live, any popular revolution is a threat to the United States. Communist is a very dangerous label, I've eventually learned. It's used to discredit any revolutionary movement. It has been used, and I used it myself constantly, to discredit any popular revolutionary movement that seeks revolutionary change or fundamental radical change in favor of the poor people. And in the so-called third world, you know, these are the vast majorities of the populations. In Nicaragua or El Salvador, Guatemala, anywhere in Latin America, the tradition has been that most of the good arable land has been cornered or brought under control through ownership by a very few families. And the vast majority of the rural population, the peasants, are, if not totally marginalized from the money economy, certainly they are living a subhuman existence, and if they have any plots of land at all, it is normally the minifundia problem, that is, plots that are too small to be economical. These so-called oligarchies are the merchants, the bankers, the commercial interests, and they are all over Latin America. And as I said before, we were the people who were most supporting them, and they were the people who, during the 1960s, were most opposed to any basic fundamental reforms. Well, getting back to the question of why social revolution is a threat to the United States, I think the analysis has to come back to the United States itself. When asking the question, why is it by definition a threat to the United States, it reminded me of when I was a trainee in the CIA. I was taught, or we were taught, that the Soviet Union's foreign policy, that is its belligerence and its expansionism abroad, was a product of its internal system, namely the requirements of the Soviet Union, of the Communist Party of the Soviet Union, to maintain a monopoly on power in that country. And I think most political scientists would agree that any society's or nation's foreign policy is largely determined or a product significantly of its internal system. And that is why in trying to raise the question and get students, for example, as I'm touring around universities, to ask themselves the questions of why is it that all this political repression is necessary? Is it in our interest, or is it in the interest of just a few people in the United States? Well, yes. Now, how is that any better? Maybe this is not even on. I don't know. All right. Well, I've tried to speak louder. I don't know if this one's... That's no better either, is it? All right. Well, I'll just speak louder then. Try to, anyway. Am I going up to 20 minutes now?
Huh? Okay, fine.
What I want to do is, when I go around, is to talk about what the CIA does a little bit, and that is the subversion of these democratic institutions, because to the degree that the CIA penetrates and controls an electoral process or a political party or a trade union, to that degree, that institution is unfree. So it's a subversion of the free nature of these institutions. That's one thing. The second thing is the paramilitary operations, which are designed to destroy a revolutionary movement through terrorism. That is the type of thing that we find in the Contra operation in these recent years during the Reagan period. But there is a third type of operation which is just as bad, probably worse, than any of those. And this third type of operation is known as liaison operations. Liaison operations are all those activities undertaken, again, in the name of anti-communism, with the local security services of foreign countries around the world. They started with the British right as soon as the CIA was established, and then they went on around the world. The CIA even set up, in many countries, security services as instruments for political control, as in Greece following the civil war there, the KYP, as in South Korea, the KCIA, as in Iran, the SAVAK, and so forth. Now, these security services are some of the nastiest services that anyone will find anywhere. They are, for example, the Guatemalan services that the CIA has worked with hand in glove since the CIA provoked overthrow of the Arbenz government in 1954. Nobody knows for sure how many, but the educated guesses are that something between 100,000 and 150,000 people have been murdered in that country since that CIA-sponsored coup more than 30 years ago. In El Salvador alone, you get something like 70,000 people kidnapped, tortured to death, and their bodies thrown along the roads since the Reagan support program began. On the other hand, you have Nicaragua, where the casualty figure now stands at up around 70,000 people, around 20,000 dead and 50,000 wounded. The comparable figure for the United States, with a population 80 times that of Nicaragua, is something like 5.5 million casualties. Once I went down to the U.S. Embassy in Madrid to the library and I added up the casualty figures for every war in which the United States has been involved for the last 100 years. And the casualty figure, the total figure, comes to less than half the comparable figure for Nicaragua, 1.9 million, I think it was. So you see what a calamity this war, this terrorist war, this fomenting of civil war in Nicaragua has been for them. It has been disastrous. And the human cost of these 50,000 people, for example, who have survived their wounds, but many of whom, many, many have lost arms and legs to live the rest of their life like that. Well, the question is, why do we have a government? Why, how do we tolerate that we do these things abroad, or that we allow a government to do these things? We allow Reagan to carry on this activity and then go on television with a smile and say, I'm a Contra too. You know, that is simply disgusting. And I think part of the answer, or a hint to the answer to why we allow this, why it's not much of an issue in this country, generally, comes in a poll on Americans' attitudes toward the government of El Salvador, published just a few months ago. It was a poll conducted by Market Opinion Research in Detroit, which I think is related to the Republicans' party. Remember, El Salvador is a country that has received $3.5 billion from the Reagan administration since 1981. It receives $1.5 million every day, a sum which annually exceeds the whole Salvadoran national budget, the government budget. It is touted, or it is praised by this administration, all its propaganda organs, as the showcase for the Reagan-Bush program of restoring democracy in Central America. Well, what do Americans think of this government? 15% of Americans, only 15%, think that El Salvador has a democratic government, despite all the government propaganda around the 1984 elections, the support to Duarte. You know, the CIA passed in millions of dollars to get Duarte elected in 1984. And as a matter of fact, he is, according to many reports, he's been on the CIA payroll for many years. 15% only believe that El Salvador has a democratic government. 33% of Americans don't have the slightest idea what kind of government El Salvador has. But then the great revelation. According to this poll, 35% of Americans believe that El Salvador has a pro-Soviet government. It doesn't say what the remaining 17% believe, but it wouldn't surprise me if they had Duarte confused with Khomeini and said El Salvador has an Islamic fundamentalist government. Well, you know, it's really ignorance, it's apathy, it's disinterest on the part of us Americans, generally speaking, certainly not the people at this conference, but generally speaking, that allows Reagan to get away with this and will probably allow Bush to do the same. Because I have been searching and talking to people looking for indications that the Bush program would be any different from the Reagan program. And so far, I haven't found a word. That means that this human cost is going to be continuing, people are going to keep on dying down there, and it could get much worse in El Salvador. As a matter of fact, I'll stop now in just a moment, but I want to mention the FEMA program, the Rex 84. I know a lot of you know about this. It was a program drawn up in the Federal Emergency Management Agency in the early 1980s in the event that the United States had to introduce troops to El Salvador or invaded Nicaragua. The government, or that is the Reagan-Bush administration, anticipated riots, big street demonstrations, a lot of civil disorder in protest against that invasion of Central America. They drew up a document whereby, and a plan, whereby the president, by the stroke of his pen, would suspend the Constitution, establish as commander-in-chief martial law in this country, and hundreds of thousands of people would be rounded up and interned on military reservations. I think they selected 12 or 14 military bases, where people would be put without trial, without charges, just on ice to get them off the streets. Now, in the plan that I've read about, supposedly these were going to be undocumented Latin Americans. But in actual fact, you know, it was going to be every one of us who went out on the street. Well, that plan, of course, is still sitting there for the president's signature. We're that close to fascism in this country, because that's what a military dictatorship would be. There would be more and more racism, you know, more and more xenophobia and so forth. Well, the problem is that it's not only that we're lucky, everybody's lucky, I think, that the invasions never happened, but that doesn't mean they can't happen under Bush, because the Salvadoran situation is getting worse and worse. The political repression is getting greater. There were more death squad assassinations during the first 5 months of this year than in all of last year. And the popular organizations are growing again in strength and taking to the streets, students, trade unionists, and so forth, and peasant organizations. These people are being selected out, or that is, chosen for selected assassination by the military and the death squads, which are the same thing practically there. And as Bush comes into office, and as this situation gets worse with the election scheduled for March, when Arena is likely to take power, or at least it is said that they could well take power from the Christian Democrats, who are all divided and as corrupt as they've ever been, that means that the situation in El Salvador for the United States is going to deteriorate, and it already is deteriorating. The FMN, the correlation between the FMLN force and the government military force is going against the government. It's going against the military. The FMLN is all dispersed in smaller units, and that has forced the military to do the same thing, which makes those military units all the more vulnerable, and so the war goes on in a more favorable fashion for the revolutionary forces. Well, what is Bush going to do about that? We are going to reach, probably within the first couple of years of the Bush administration, the danger again that troops might have to be introduced to El Salvador and perhaps an invasion of Nicaragua. Who knows? Because the Contra have not been able to do it. The only other alternative, if you want to solve things by force, is military. So this document of FEMA is very important. We may be on the verge of that in very few years. Thank you all very much for your attention.
Thank you, Phil. Now we will turn the floor over to Edgar Chamorro.
Last week, I watched in TV the story told by himself, Mr. Eli Wiesel, or Wiesel, the man of the Holocaust, who have been writing so many books on that story. And he was very candid, you know, saying that after he went through the horror, he didn't want to talk at all about it until Mr. François Mauriac persuaded him, once he was a guest of him, and stayed with him and told him, he told the story that Mauriac is a Christian, a Catholic, and he was talking about Jesus Christ suffering so much and so on. I said, well, Mauriac back and forth with Jesus Christ suffering and Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ. So he said, finally, I have to give it back to him, you know, with this Jesus Christ suffering, you know, so much. So he told him that he thought that the Jewish people have suffered much more than Jesus Christ. And that, and Mauriac walked away and then finally stopped him and looked at him and says, if you feel like that, why don't you go out and talk about it? He says, that made him think that it's important to talk about things that we don't like to talk. I tell you this story because I just watched this in TV and it impressed me, because it's very hard to go around talking about this. This is almost my fourth year. I am not doing too much, thanks God, this year, but the year of the Reagan trying to get $270 million, he tried to get the second time after the $100 million. So I was invited by many groups to go and talk. It's very hard, you know, because what I am finding very frustrating is that the more you talk, the more you get caught in this kind of, I don't know how you call it, you know, like a game plan, or it fits the other side, that, and we go nowhere, and the people in Nicaragua keep suffering. So every time I'm invited, this time I accept, of course, you know, a Bill Shapp and Ellen Reid in the Media Institute were the first people when I left the contrast that came to visit me, and they invited me to write my story. They thought it was important. For me, it was very painful to go, you know, living through that again, because you have to really go through your life, you know, and think, what did I do that? I mean, why I let these people use me? And what's wrong with me? I mean, after all, you know, because anytime you do something like that, you are questioning yourself, your character, your personality, your intelligence, your man of what, integrity or so on, or why you were so stupid or so a fool, you know. So it becomes a very painful, and I want to say that because I am going through that kind of crisis, you know, I don't even want to talk about it too much. But I think it's important, you know, at least once in a while. I accepted first to go to the World Court with an affidavit. I said, well, that will do it, you know, nobody will ask me again, you know, because it's written there. Go and read my affidavit, please don't want to talk about it. But no, once you do something like that, the press come, there are good people writing good books, you know, there are like 20 books on the contrast, and the way the United States have been deceived and so on out there. And I can see myself in many of those, not even quoted many times, but I am there. And sometimes full chapters, you know. But the real point I want to say is that once you go out to talk, then people come more, and then there are reporters, articles, people who are writing for history, or for the media of TV and so on. And you know you are being used again, you know. And then I decided I'm going back to Nicaragua. Of course, Nicaragua wants to use me too, you know. And I have a problem with this thing about using people. I think I am coming to a difficult problem with the instrumentalization of people. And I think it's a key element, at least in the extreme left, what I call the extreme left, the very radical, and the extreme right. I have been trying to find myself in the center, you know, I don't know what is the center, because it's very relative, you know. When I was criticizing Reagan is so much to the right that I might be a radical leftist, you know, because he's so much to the right. He makes me look too much to the left, you know. Now they bring somebody, they call it a moderate, you know, like, he could be more moderate, but what does it mean that, you know? Also, you know, so I am finding that one of the problems is this instrumentalization of people. That's why, for me, it's very hard to keep talking, and because I think the one of the elements we have to understand about CIA, and I believe also of some of the extreme governments that we call of the left radical, is this concept of man that is to be used. You know? I have seen many movements of the left using people, and movements of the right, and so on. So I say that because you know I am going through that particular crisis. I am in the not really seeing the usefulness, but I think, okay, I wanted to start with those words of Mr. Elie Wiesel, that it's important to talk because of the horror, you know, the horror. And I think that intellectuals, academics, analysts like to make things in abstracts. And I myself, you know, I have here, you know, a very abstract outline, you know, and but the problem is how to translate to you the pain of being used, because I think it's important. For me, the most revulsive thing I felt when I accepted money from the CIA, that I guess that's what makes you a recruited person once you accept money. First, you know, I felt I was not recruited, that the CIA was working for me, you know, because my ego, my personality says, no, I mean, the United States, we can use them to go back to power. It's a Nicaraguan power struggle. The Chamorros want to go back to power. My group, my aristocratic group, my elite group, my whatever, you know, we want to go back to power and we'll use the United States. And there's some of that also. So I say, well, we'll use them, and, but you really find out that you're not using them. They're just using you. Because in any moment that you want to have an influence in the movement or to be independent, you are cut off from meetings or from money or from whatever, you know? Or just they make you believe that you are somebody and you are not. They still flatter you, that they need you, they need your face, they need your name, they need your to be a victim, maybe, you know? Or to be a martyr, you know, but they need you. I want to jump to another experience that was very painful for me and was what made me leave, really. When I had to work with this CIA case officer who brought the manual on psychological operation. I believe it's a very important book to read for Americans if they want to understand what is the CIA all about. That little book called The Manual on Psych Ops, you know, is a totally not anti-communist. It's a communist in the purest sense of the word, manual, where all the techniques or all the tactics or whatever expertise that have been accumulated, you know, to force people, to recruit people, to embarrass people, to humiliate people, to martyrize people, to victimize people, are there. So, you know, that compendium, you know, of these tactics was brought by the CIA to me. And I was responsible because I was the PR man, and at the same time, I was in charge of the political education. And the need for a political education came that the Contras were being trained by Argentinians, who were, I mean, from the military junta of Argentina, I mean, you know, a very fascist group, really, who had a very, you know, simplistic approach to things. So very brutal and very cruel. And in some discussion, I have been, you know, visiting Contras and talking to the soldiers being trained, and I asked them, why do you fight? If they ask you, you know, why do you come here? I mean, so they didn't know why they were fighting. I said, but what would you tell people once you take Ocotal? I mean, you are in Ocotal, you finish shooting people, there are a few survivors. You know, there is a woman there, a man there, a child. What do you tell them? You victorious Contra, you walk into Ocotal. What is your line? Not a word. I mean, these people were just trained to kill, you know, to destroy, to damage. But you say, but the Sandinista, I tried to defend you. I remember the Sandinista from school. I mean, they were full of ideas. They could write papers. They were using dittos. They didn't get any money, but they were people who had a lot of ideas in their heads. I mean, a lot of ideas and paper writing and talking to people and grassroots everywhere, grassroots. And, okay. But the contras don't have anything. Do you have a political platform? Do you have a plan? Have you ever heard a contra leader talking about political education, about schools once they take over? Have you heard of a contra leader with an idea? So I said, you know, what? I mean, I was embarrassed in the CIK's office. I said, why do you do? We need it. So I heard that the idea went as far as Washington, and Jim Kirkpatrick, and so on. They said, you know, we need to give them a little book, you know. So the guideline. We have made the joke, you know, we need like Mao red book or Gaddafi green book. We need what I call at that time a blue book. And I start working on my own little blue book that in some places is there. But the tragedy of that was that they sent us this black book called the Psychological Operations Manual, something taken from Fort Bragg's, you know the story. So it's very important, I am saying, for you people to read that and see that that book is about instrumentalization. Brutal, simplistic instrumentalization where you create martyrs, you assassinate judges, you selectively, of course, you know, no random killing. You know, the great advance in education in the United States is from random killing to selective killing, you know. So that those are the qualitative changes, you know, that make difference between deterministic societies, materialistic society, and democratic societies, where there is a higher degree of sophistication, of